I am Rob Curley. I am the editor of the Orange County Register. So I know what you all are thinking. You thought I would look a lot older. I grew up in a really tiny town in Kansas, and my parents subscribed to three newspapers, and I read them all. All I've ever wanted to do is be a journalist since the third grade, which meant I've had no luck with girls since I was like 11. But I read these newspapers and I loved them, and my heroes were these journalists. And I watched as the journalism world changed. The role of a newspaper is to me exactly the same that it's always been. The difference is now we have Facebook and Twitter and social media and the internet and iPhones and YouTube, but the role of the newspaper is the same. The newspaper should be where you go to talk about important ideas and talk about what things matter in your community and have thoughtful discussions about these things. So this past summer, Donna Wares, our managing editor, began having book club events where we'd bring everybody in and we would talk about ideas and thoughts, and we'd have these great discussions. And I remember the very first time we had one, I thought 19, 20 people might show up. And it was packed like this. And then the next one was packed. And the next one was packed. And then we said, it's been great talking about books, but we should talk about other things that are important in the community. And I remember when we talked about, we should talk about the justice system in Orange County. And I said, okay, so this one will actually only get like 18 or 19. Well, we ran an ad in the newspaper, and within 2 days, it's completely sold out. And the moral of that story is newspaper advertising works. Remember that. For those of you who own a business, it works. So because I didn't expect this, I'm sorry, Don. I don't mean to embarrass you. I'm going to need you all to can you scoot in? Because my mom's not going to believe this. So hang on. I'm actually going to work this. Okay. Can you all wave a little bit, maybe? Yeah, that's great. So thank you all for coming. We want to continue to have these. Thank you. With that, I want to introduce our panel's moderator, Donna Wares. She is our newspaper's managing editor and one of my favorite editors in the world. And when it comes to stories that involve the justice system, she's probably one of the best editors in the country. I can't even believe how lucky we are to have her. So, Donna, it's your show. Take it over. Thank you all for coming.
Thank you, Rob. And thank you, everyone, for joining us. We're really hoping to have a conversation about issues that are very important to all of us in Orange County. And fortunately, tonight's panel features some of the people who have been at the center of our ongoing discussion about the use of jailhouse informants here in Orange County. And it's an issue that has been a subject of great debate elsewhere. So we thought, let's bring everyone in and talk about what's going to happen next in the Orange County justice system. First, I'd like to start off by introducing our panelists and thanking them for being here tonight. We have Mr. Tony Rackauckas, the Orange County District Attorney. You all probably know he's been a homicide prosecutor. He's been a judge. And since 1998, he's been the district attorney here and is currently in his fourth term. We're also fortunate to have Sheriff Sandra Hutchens. She's a veteran of the Los Angeles Police Department, and she came to Orange County as sheriff in 2008. She supervises a department of 4,000 staff, including the staff that runs the Orange County jails. Over here to my left, we have Mr. Scott Sanders. He's the assistant public defender. And he has spent a lot of time during the past few years investigating and talking about and challenging the police use of jailhouse informants, and has filed quite a few motions and has had quite an interesting time in our court system. So I look forward to hearing from him this evening as well. We also have, from the district attorney, we have Ebrahim Baytieh, in the yellow tie. He is an assistant district attorney who works with Mr. Rackauckas, and he currently supervises the office's special prosecution unit. So it means he gets all the really cool cases. To my left, we have one of my favorite people, Tony Saavedra. He has been our lead reporter, writing about the legal system in Orange County, and has been particularly focused on the issues of jailhouse informants for nearly 2 years now. Tony has been with the Register for 25 years. At the end of our panel, we have Edward Humes. He's a Pulitzer Prize-winning author of 14 books, including the upcoming book, Door to Door. And Ed won his Pulitzer Prize here at the Register, and he occasionally still writes for us, including he compiled our e-book, Inside the Snitch Tank. All of you have a copy on your desk, not on your desk, on your seat, so you're welcome to take it home with you. So before we talk about the future of the Orange County justice system, I wanted to revisit a date in history, recent history. It was a very terrible date, October 12th, 2011. And that was the day of the worst mass shooting in Orange County history. 8 people died in a Seal Beach salon. Countless other lives have been forever changed.
It was October 12, 2011, in the aftermath of the mass shooting carried out by a vengeful Scott Evan Decry that claimed 8 lives. Orange County District Attorney Tony Rackauckas led the charge for justice.
The circumstances of this case are so terrible and incomprehensible. I will, of course, seek the death penalty against Scott Evan Decry for the intentional, methodical murders of Victoria Buzo, David Cowette, Laura Allady, Randy Fannin, Michelle Fass, Michelle Fournier, Lucia Condes, and Christy Wilson. We'll make sure that each victim will be remembered, and we'll make sure that we seek justice for each individual person.
Ed Humes, you wrote the Register's ebook, and you live in Seal Beach. Can you talk about what it was like being at ground zero after the Seal Beach shooting?
Oh, what was it like? The first thing I think you need to know about Seal Beach is it's California's last little beach town. It's the kind of place where the locals relish living in maybe the only Orange County coastal community that you could correctly call quaint. You know, it's 7 years leading up to this mass murder, there had been one homicide in all that time in Seal Beach. So in a way, along with the friends, the neighbors, the families that were lost in this terrible crime. This massacre also devastated the belief, or maybe it was the illusion, that Seal Beach was somehow immune to this sort of mass violence. The other thing about Seal Beach is the kind of place that comes together when things get bad. Hundreds of people turned out at the salon after the murder for a candlelight vigil to share comfort and grief. And it's kind of one of those moments you never forget. It was terrible, and it was beautiful at the same time. And the one bit of relief, if you could call it that, that I think the people of Seal Beach felt was that they didn't have to be afraid that there was a killer still on the loose. The shooter had been caught. You know, he had confessed. That part of it was over. It didn't have to be stacked on top of their loss and their shock. But no one had any inkling, I think, at that time that the case would take the turn that it did, that the focus would shift from a terrible crime to questions about the integrity of the justice system. And certainly nobody expected that, you know, now going on 5 years later, that the there'd be no resolution in sight, and that there'd be even more questions now than there were at that time.
So, Mr. Rackauckas, after the killings, there was an immediate arrest and a confession. And at some point after the arrest, the prosecution team decided to use a jailhouse informant. And I wonder if you could talk a little bit about what the thinking was behind that.
Of course. Right, when the case first occurred after the defendant was arrested, and he was put into a cell, a medical isolation cell, because he had to be protected. He couldn't be with anybody else. But coincidentally, he was put into that cell next to a person who had been working with a federal joint task force as an informant. Now, you know, that particular task force was working because they were working with informants because there was a lot of violence in the jail. There were battles going on between factions of the Mexican Mafia, and the Mexican Mafia was running gangs in the street from the jail. So it was a really terrible situation. So that task force took it upon itself to investigate, to try to quell that problem. And in doing so, they used informants. And they got, in particular, they got informants who were high up in the Mexican Mafia. And there was one particular informant named, it doesn't matter what his name is, as of Fernando Perez, but he was had been doing a lot of work. They had pretty much completed their efforts. The U.S. attorney put together about 99 cases against members of the Mexican Mafia and various street gang members in Orange County, and you know, as you could expect, a person who's been working as an informant, if it's found out, if his identity comes to light, his life expectancy would be very short. He would not have long to live. And so they had determined that he was pretty much done as an informant, and they were going to protect him, protect his identity, put him into a witness protection program, and they put him into this medical isolation cell that Scott DeCry was later put into. And within a short time, this informant started telling some people in the, some deputies in the Orange County Jail, or a deputy in the Orange County Jail, that Scott DeCry was talking about his case, and he was bragging about it. Now, you ask the question, why? Why would anybody be interested in using an informant in a case like Scott DeCry, where the evidence was exceptionally strong that he was the guilty party? There wasn't any question about it, and there wasn't much question about what he had done, kind of how he had done it. But you know, if you remember the Alloway case, you understand that, and that was the the biggest mass murder before to cry. And the Alloway case was similar. It was not a whodunit. The arrest was made on the campus at Cal State Fullerton, where all these murders happened. Yet he was found not guilty by reason of insanity. And Scott DeCry had some psychiatric issues in his past. There were some concerns about the possibility of him deciding to, or his counsel deciding to go after an insanity plea. So when our deputies learned that he was talking about the killing, they thought it was worth listening. And so they talked to the informant. He said that he wasn't asking for anything. He was there. He heard this person talking. He was volunteering information. So what they decided to do was to have a recording, have the jail cell, the two cells bugged so that their conversation could be recorded, and then any future statements made by DeCry would be very clear. There would be no need to depend on the reliability of the informant in order to tell our deputies what those statements were. It would all be tape recorded, and you could listen to it. And they informed, or they instructed this informant not to ask any questions, because Scott DeCry had already been charged with a crime. He probably already had counsel, and defendant has a right not to be asked questions when he's in jail and he's been charged with a crime and has counsel. So they instructed him not to ask any questions, but simply to be a listening post. And then sometime later, some days or weeks later, after there had been a lot of conversation, the Seal Beach police detective then got the tapes and listened to the tapes. There's no quick way to do it. There were hundreds of hours of tapes, but he listened to that in real time, and then told our deputy district attorneys that, hey, there's some statements here of interest to you. And so our deputies listened to those statements, and they asked, one of the first questions was, well, was it something elicited by this informant? Were they just statements he was making? And our people decided that no, he wasn't asking any questions. He was just saying things like, what's up? Wow. Things like that. And the statements that he made were just chilling statements of the crime. Why he did what he did, how he did it, how much he hated his wife, how much he didn't care about the other people, how methodical he was. And actually, pretty darn good evidence that would, as far as the insanity, to rebut any possible insanity defense. And so, having received that, then our deputies made discovery to the defense, to the extent of telling them, about the informant, about the tapes, giving them the tapes, and so forth. And then and it kind of went from there.
Thank you. Mr. Sanders, you represented Scott DeCry almost from the beginning, and how did you learn about the use of the jailhouse informants, and what made you decide to take your investigation so much further than just your client? You've taken it to encompass so much of the legal system.
Well, first of all, I had two clients at the time. Two capital defendants, Daniel Wozniak and Scott DeCry. I don't know if the district attorney's office knew that I realized this, but both of the defendants had made statements to the same informant named Fernando Perez. That was the allegation. So the starting point was kind of this extraordinary coincidence that two capital defendants had contact with an informant in the jail. And so we kind of embarked upon our own investigation. We started to look at history and facts that we thought were important. We looked at the minute orders in his case. We could see that he had been transported to federal court, apparently to testify in a case. We looked at his background and his history. And it didn't, of course, quite obviously, it didn't sound quite right to us that there was this informant who was lucky enough on two occasions to end up with incriminating statements from two capital defendants. And it's still the same kind of version we would hear throughout, that it was all a coincidence in both of these cases. We then asked the district attorney's office to provide us with evidence about the background of the informant. We didn't know he was, we knew he was an informant. We knew they weren't acknowledging his informant status. But we didn't have a sense of what was about to come. And so we pushed that issue, and luckily we got a ruling in January of 2013 in which Judge Goethals basically said, over the objection of the district attorney's office, their plan was to never let us know anything about Fernando Perez as an informant, and that's an important point. We could have easily been here today without that ruling in January of 2013, having no idea who this person was. And what we found as we got the materials, we basically got the materials from all of the 10 cases in which he had provided information. So the statement that Mr. Perez had indicated that he didn't want anything in return was belied by the fact that, and easily understandable by prosecutors, by the fact that he was a third striker who had been convicted. The prosecutor in that case, Eric Peterson, had recommended a 25-to-life sentence. And so he had all the incentive in the world to work off his sentence in whichever way he could, and that's what he did. For a year, his only job in custody was to work as an informant. That's what he did day and night. He produced 200 pages of notes. He talked about all his activities in a wide range of cases.
What's wrong with that?
There's nothing wrong with the fact that he did the work, as long as that work was done legally, in the sense of he's not questioning inmates who are charged with crimes. And it's also not wrong if you turn over the evidence that allows people to evaluate the credibility of the informants and determine whether that Messiah violation took place. We talk about Messiah, that's the questioning of a defendant who's been charged. And when we looked at it, and we started to look at each of those cases and work through those cases, and the notes of a second informant named Oscar Morial, who wrote 300 pages of notes in his work. These two informants basically worked nonstop in the jail for 2 years. To your question, they can do it. And I know that the argument is, and I understand it, that law enforcement needs this work done. Just play by the rules. I mean, the bottom line here is what we looked at time and time again as we looked at note by note, and then we compared it to what happened in the cases, was they weren't playing by the rules. They weren't turning over the notes that mattered. And as this paper and other papers have covered it, that's what took place. They were not turning over notes that demonstrated the Messiah violations. They were not turning over the notes that impeached credibility. And they were not turning over notes that showed, I know what you'd like to understand is, why did it matter here? So let's say it happened in other cases. What we were arguing was there's a pattern within the jail of making these illegal encroachments upon inmates, not disclosing it to people, making movements that are unlawful in order to get those statements. And so that was the process. The process was a year of studying those movements, studying the transcripts, looking at the cases, and what we found time and time again was all the things that we suspected were going on.
Mr. Baytieh, any comment?
I mean, it's interesting because, yes, we have to play by the rules, but that's a two-way street. I think it is important to understand that there is a need in our system to use informants. The concern that I have, and I understand that defense can say in certain cases rules were not followed, and that's why we have the court. We go to court and we litigate these issues. But the concern that I have from my perspective is this general notion that they are hiding evidence. They are intentionally hiding evidence. They're not playing by the rules. That's the part that gets to me, is that if you have specific allegations about specific cases, that's why we go to court and we litigate these issues. But the notion that there is this conspiracy or there is this attempt to intentionally hide evidence from the defense, from my perspective, it's not supported by the facts. Look at all these allegations that were made. Not in a single case did somebody come and say that the DA's office intentionally did not give evidence, knowing that that evidence should be discovered.
Sheriff Hutchens, the Register has written extensively about the network of jail informants used at the jail, and I was wondering if you could talk a bit about how the jail informant system is supposed to work and how you were, the staff was trained or supposed to be protecting the safeguards of defendants like Mr. Decry while they're awaiting trial.
Well, first of all, the notion that we have a network of jail informants and we have special handling deputies that are spending all of their time moving these informants into convenient places is false. With respect to Mr. Decry, Mr. Rackauckas is correct. You know, informants who are in protective custody and inmates who are capital cases or notoriety or inmates who need protection in our jails, such as child molesters, they end up in these same type of cells because they're in protective custody. Mr. Decry, in addition to what Mr. Rackauckas said, was placed at the request of nursing staff, medical staff, so that there would be a line of sight because they were concerned that he might commit suicide. So that was another reason why he was placed where he was placed. There's much has been said that we have special handling deputies, and I have 6,000 inmates in my jails that I'm responsible for. And I have, you've heard about some of the kinds of inmates we have in that jail. So I'm responsible for keeping people apart from one another who might harm one another or harm the deputies. And so I'm responsible for their safety and security. That requires a pretty elaborate classification system. You've heard a lot, you've heard TREAD a lot. And you've heard TREAD referred to as a informant management system. Well, it is not. It is a classification database. It is not an informant management system. Every inmate who is booked into our custody is in that system, every single one, so that we have a history of what their priors are, what were they problems when they were in custody before, were they victimized when they were in custody before, where should they be housed, all the things that our special handling deputies work day in and day out to make sure that jail runs smoothly and we can reduce the numbers of assaults on inmates and reduce the number of assaults on our deputies. So no, there is not, there was an operation reference to the federal informant on the Mexican mafia that was reported in the register because we, when you have inmates who are involved in gangs out in the street and they come into the jail, they run their operations from the jail. And so we were able to disrupt a number of narcotics activities, assaults, prevent a number of assaults, and ended up with the conviction of many, many individuals who are not on the street victimizing people because of that operation.
But the use of informants was organized, whether it's a network. We had people in your department and the system talk about how inmates actually apply. How useful are the informants? I mean, do you find it to be a valuable tool?
We don't recruit informants in the jail. What happens in the jail is, for example, with Scott Decry, is inmate came forward to a deputy. The deputy will call typically whatever agency handled that case, and in this case it was Seal Beach, and then there'll be a conversation with the district attorney's office about whether or not anything is going to occur there. I will say that in the street, you ask the question, a lot of people say, why do you work with informants? I can tell you as a former investigator, as a former patrol deputy, sometimes that's the only way you can get into these organizations, particularly narcotics and gangs, is where they're most effective. I'd like to remind everybody about this, though, too. There's not a single case that was solely made, that I'm aware of, that was ever solely made on the statement of an informant. There's always other evidence. And respect to what Mr. Baytieh said, that's for a judge to decide. Or that's for a jury to decide when we bring all the evidence forward. And I agree with Mr. Sanders. It has to be done certainly with respect to the inmates' rights, with respect to Messiah. We don't want to violate anybody's rights. We did find that we needed more training in our jails on Messiah. We needed to make sure that our deputies who work in those jails, not exposed to that, knew, understood those rules. And we also tightened up our policies and procedures when an informant does approach one of our personnel and has information so that they know what they can legally do or what they can't do.
Can I respond briefly?
I was going to come back to you in a second. Can I ask Tony a question real quick? Tony, what are some of the most surprising things that you discovered in your investigation of the use of snitches?
One of the most surprising things was how much money, in some cases, was being paid and not by the DA's office, but by the various police agencies to some of these informants. Two in particular, in an 18-month period, collected $150,000 combined for their informant work.
And these were in custody?
These were in custody. I should say at a large part of their custody was at the Anaheim Police Department. They got things like Del Taco deliveries. They got Xbox games. They got, one guy got a carton of Marlboros. It was just surprising to see the things that they got. Another thing that surprised me is that the cases that I looked at, it wasn't a matter of just someone overhearing something and saying, well, I got to do my duty and step up. I mean, these were people who had been organized and were going after confessions after confession after confession. It wasn't just a matter of serendipity.
Thank you. So, Mr. Sanders, how do we make sure, I think this is going to go back to the issue you, how do we make sure we have the dual causes of fair trial and public safety served in these kinds of cases? What do you think we could be doing better?
Well, first of all, I would just come back to the issue of that there has been no evidence of intentional. First of all, we've got to be straight about where we're at right now. And the notion that somehow we just lodged a whole bunch of accusations. We filed, I think in total now, 1,400 pages of motions with 25,000 pages of documents, and the response basically back. And this does make us less safe in the sense of the prosecution's not credible when they make claims like, we've just pulled this out of thin air, when we supply 25,000 pages of documents, and their response to our allegations are, trust us, our deputies wouldn't do anything. That doesn't advance anything here. That doesn't make anybody in the criminal justice community believe you anymore because you say, trust us. We give you facts, we give you details, and the response is basically, our people wouldn't do that. Now, I could sit here all night, and I will stay here all night. I'm telling you right now, I don't care when it ends. I'm willing to stay here outside. We can go out, and we can keep talking about these things, and we should. Because to say things like, there's no evidence, anybody can say those words. We've put it down on paper. We've asked to litigate this as much as we can. Some courts have ruled the litigation could be full. Some have said that haven't. But come on, we're at a point where we have some understanding of what's going on here. The notion here, we are literally moving backwards right now. Less safe, less reliable is the system when right now, we're sitting here 3 years into it almost, 2.5 years, and they are telling us there was never a secret informant network. Mr. Rackauckas wrote that in a letter to the editor 2 weeks ago. I don't know if they understand this. Their deputies have admitted it. They've already said it. Let me read from this for a moment. Their deputies wrote in a search warrant affidavit, Deputy Seth Tunstall wrote, one of my responsibilities in special handling, and this is a quote, developing confidential informants. He said, I have cultivated, interviewed, and supervised numerous confidential informants. That was one of the most veteran special handling deputies in the jail, 10 years in service when he wrote that declaration. To sit here and say, we don't have a secret informant network. Maybe it's not a secret informant network anymore because we now know about it. But it was a secret when you started, and you're now telling us it doesn't exist. Jonathan Larson, one of your special handling deputies, I asked him the question on the stand. Were you a handler in the jail? Yes. What did that mean? I was overseeing an inmate who was giving us information. How often would you meet with him? Once a week. Where were those meetings? He goes on to describe all that. He says, question, is there a tank in the jail where you put your informants from time to time to collect information? Yes. And is that the JMOD? Yes, and that has been the JMOD in the past. So question, you put high-value inmates and you put some of the informants in there. Is that right? Yes. So why are we talking right now about whether you had a jail informant program? And who are you denying? Are you denying, are you saying that these officers were not telling the truth? Or are we going to finally be candid? You've run a program now for 25 years, and while the TREDs are not a database of informants, they have all sorts of critical key information to understanding informants, their activities, whether they're credible. So let's be candid. You didn't turn it over for 25 years and people have paid prices. Human beings have been in custody not getting information they should have gotten for 25 years. So I'm not ready to move on, and none of us should be ready to move on
until we fix the harms from the past. And that those harms including not turning that evidence over to people, human beings in custody who have suffered not having the evidence to which they're entitled.
The topic of our conversation tonight was the future of the Orange County justice system. And I was wondering if Sheriff Hutchens, you could talk about some of the systems and reforms that you felt that you needed to put in place in response to some of the previous cases that have come up.
Sure. Well, first...
Or if you had a response.
Yes. There was, there were three large investigations involving informants that were very well known, have been reported in the paper, and have been tried in court, so it's not like they were secret. So yes, these deputies were involved in two of those were federal investigations, so that's not a secret. With respect to the information that's available in our classification database, Mr. Sanders is well aware of that database because he's actually submitted discovery to county council whenever there's any information that an attorney wants about one of our inmates that's in custody. They submit a request. It goes to our county council, who then sometimes calls them out, calls them up to find out specifically what do you need if they don't understand the discovery. And then that goes before a judge, because part of our system is a secret system in terms of security issues, and a judge will decide that in court. So there's no secret here. They've always been aware that that's been there. It's always been there. And a judge decides whether or not, you know, that balance test, is this going to impact the security of the jail, or do they need to turn it over? That information on classification was turned over in the Chamberlain case to at least 9 attorneys. And so, again, it should not be a secret to anybody. With respect to reforms, we can always do better. You know, all of us can always do better. And so we took a look at the training that our deputies working special handling received in terms of Brady and Messiah, and made sure that they've gotten additional training and training throughout the department. I attended the training myself just to see what it was all about. I thought it was very good training. And we've tightened up our policy and procedures so that instead of, we operate on an old jail management system, and it's a system we have to deal with. So there might be information in different pots, if you will. We've determined where all of that is. So when we get discovery requests, it goes to a single point, and that person can make sure that we have responded effectively to that request. Again, going through county council. We always go through county council when we do that. We've tightened up our procedures with respect to dealing with informants, both on the street and in custody. Now, I want to clarify one issue, too. Deputy sheriffs working in the jail and other employees working in the jail, they get information every day from inmates. It's not always confidential informants, though. Sometimes it's an inmate that said, you know, there's going to be a fight in this dorm tonight, so I want to let you know, deputy. Or I think there, if you look at such and such a bed, you're going to find some contraband. So every day, that's not a confidential informant. That's an inmate giving information. And that's part of the job of the special handling deputies. And the deputies, any of the personnel that work at the jail, that get that information to act on it. So sometimes I think those two get confused when we talk about working with confidential informant versus just getting information from an inmate in custody.
To our prosecutors, in March, the district attorney's office was removed from the Decry case. I know that case is under appeal and that you disagree with the judge's ruling. But at the same time, you have indicated that mistakes were made. And I'd like to, for you, and I would put it to either of you, to talk about specifically what mistakes you felt were made and how you were moving forward to correct them.
Well, in the Decry case, as you know, that there were motions that took about 4 months. A lot of witnesses were called, a lot of documents were entered, and the motions didn't really just involve or didn't revolve around the Decry case. They got spread out into a lot of different cases, primarily other gang cases. Now, and those tended to be cases where the informants who had worked in the federal gang task force were involved in some of those cases. Now, that federal joint federal task force was operated by the U.S. attorney, not us. And so, and we didn't have the information concerning a lot of it until we started developing that information at the decry hearings. And as we did develop that information, then we took the action that was necessary. So, for example, there was a case where that came out of that federal gang task force where a person was prosecuted, a person named Vega. Was prosecuted and convicted, and an informant named Moriel, who was mentioned already by Mr. Sanders, testified, and the testimony there didn't indicate that there were any violations of rights. But then later in the decry hearings, as we were getting more and more information, we got additional information from the sources that we hadn't had it before. We learned that there was that there were notes that Moriel had concerning his discussions with this Mr. Vega that indicated that he had asked him some questions before. That there was they had some prior discussions. He was working with the federal government to try to find out what Vega was doing, who the leaders were in the Mexican mafia, and those notes came up along with some of the other things. So that actually appeared to us to be a pretty clear violation. So first thing we did was, from my office point of view, we contacted the defense in that case and let them know that there was some discovery that they hadn't had, and agreed to reverse that trial, to set it for a retrial, so that there wouldn't, that the defendant would have a clean start. And as far as that is concerned, without that particular witness. So there was that. There were a couple of discovery things that were found. But I heard Mr. Sanders' passionate statement here a few minutes ago. But in all of that, in all of those hearings for all of those months with all of those witnesses, there was no intentional violation of anything. There was no intentional misconduct by any of the people in the district attorney's office, not found. The judge specifically found that misconduct that he found in the decry case was not intentional and was negligent. And so when we're constantly being accused of crimes here, but there is no criminal conduct taking place, and it's you know, Mr. Sanders is saying, "Wow, we know what's going on because we've done all this work. We've filed thousands and thousands of pages of documents," but the number of pages doesn't really matter too much. It's the truthfulness of it. It's the importance and the relevance of what he's filing. So there are a lot of false accusations in that batch of pages. The judge in the Wozniak case called when Mr. Sanders was alleging 30 years of misconduct by the DAs, referred to it as revisionist history and undisguised speculation, and that's what it was. So we're kind of in a situation here where Mr. Sanders is making these sensational allegations. The evidence that's really coming out is that there have been mistakes. There have been some discovery violations. There have been a couple of these what we call messiah violations, or violating somebody's right not to be asked questions when he's in the jail. But that's pretty much the extent of it. And I wanted to just talk about one thing very quickly that Mr. Saavedra brought up about these investigations, the informants, and how he was surprised as to what was going on, particularly in the Anaheim City Jail. That is a different situation, though, because they were using an investigative, maybe still are, using an investigative technique in Anaheim, where these are cases that they are in fact having these informants talk to the suspects prior to any charges have been brought, prior to any charges being brought. And that is not, that's not a violation. The only time it would be a violation if it's prior to any charges being brought would be if it was involuntary. And so it, that's a little bit of a different situation there. And they've determined that, that they've decided that that's a good way for them to do investigations. They present us with that information, then we have the choice to make. Either we accept it and file a case, or we don't. And so we're reviewing those on a case-by-case basis. But any of those cases that we do file, it's with a whole package of discovery about those particular informants and all the benefits that they've gotten and all the other cases that they've worked on. So it's a huge discovery bill, frankly, with respect to those cases. And we're not excited about getting those, but we're not doing those investigations either.
So last week at UCI Law School, when Mr. Sanders was talking with Mr. Baytieh, I attended the debate, you called for appointing a lawyer for everyone, every defendant in Orange County who has had a jailhouse informant used against them.
Right, I mean, and one of the reasons that has to happen is because of responses like this. When Mr. Rackauckas says the district attorney's office has been cleared of intentional wrongdoing in all of these cases, that's an absolute fabrication. Judge Goethals didn't clear them of intentional wrongdoing in the cases separate of what happened in Decry. Didn't address that, except to say Mr. Peterson lied or misled. Two deputies from the jail lied or misled. People were moved improperly, and that wasn't disclosed. Evidence wasn't disclosed. That's not a clearing of anybody from any understanding that I have of the term clearing.
Well, wait a minute. Now, Judge Goethals.
Can I have my moment?
No, just a second, because Judge Goethals was very clear. He was very clear that the attorneys in the Decry case did not commit any misconduct.
I said, except for the Decry case. He came back then, which a point you left, did new hearings in which, by the way, your deputy stood by and let deputies lie and mislead in court. Not once did they stand up to what was obvious perjury and the hiding of evidence regarding treads. If people don't understand what took place in these hearings, you should. In the hearings, we spent 4 months taking testimony in which deputies pretended as if they had no idea whether there was any information out there that could explain or help them understand whether inmates had been moved and the conditions of that. Only through a lucky break that we got a subpoena response that basically revealed treads. Despite what Ms. Hutchens said, no, I did not know about treads before 2014, nor did Judge Goethals, who said in the first 25 years of his career he never heard of the term treads. So what happened was the deputies, over the course of 3 months, basically misled us. We sat there and were misled for 3 months as they pretended they had no answers and no idea how we could get more information about why individuals were moved. Why was the district attorney's office removed? Because the position of the court was the district attorney's office either did not want to or would not turn over that evidence.
That is not the ruling, though. You're saying this like it's some kind of
a fact. Have your chance
that
to
was
respond.
Not the court's ruling.
You'll have your chance to respond.
Obviously, we have a difference of opinion here.
Yeah.
Mr. Rackauckas, what have you read and studied through the course of your investigation? You have declared, you've had the temerity to basically clear everyone in your office of intentional misconduct. What have you read? What have you studied? Have you read a transcript?
I read your allegations.
Have you read a transcript?
I read some of the transcripts, and I read your allegation about, for example, our deputy district attorney and the sheriff's department being in collusion to have NBC lockup. Interview.
Do you know you're wrong about that as well?
I know you're wrong. I'm not.
I never actually accused the prosecutor of being in collusion. You said you've read the documents.
Excuse me, could we take a break? Obviously, we have a difference of opinion here. All right, our intention this evening is to have a conversation here. We're not going to have a brawl. So I wanted to change the subject. Legal experts have called for an outside investigation, which I know the defense attorneys have thought is a good idea. We have outside legal attorneys who have called for it, and now Mr. Rackauckas. I put this out to the floor. Does anyone know the status of that federal investigation? Is there, in fact, going to be one?
Well, I've sent a letter to the U.S. attorney to ask the U.S. attorney to go ahead and investigate our office if they'd like. I would be happy to have them come investigate and clear the air as to all of these allegations.
Clear the air of the allegations.
Clear the air.
Do you have an Orange County informant index in your office?
Well, of course we do.
Have you been turning over evidence for the past 30 years from the Orange County informant index where there's been Brady
material?
We have been turning
over evidence as it's required under the rules of discovery for the past 30 years and more.
Based upon what
an... All right, now, look, when you have an informant, and I mentioned this a little bit ago, when there's somebody who's in custody and that person is an informant, there's a fine line that has to be looked at and drawn, because if the identity of that informant becomes known, then there are people who would like to kill the informant, and so it puts his life in danger. And so even the penal code gives the prosecution not only a right but a duty to maintain the confidentiality of the identity of informants. And so, we don't publicize the informant index. It would be very wrongful to do such a thing. Mr. Sanders, on the other hand, in the Wozniak case, published identity of informants, witnesses, their addresses, and that sort of thing, risking their lives. And that's the reason why we have to be careful about giving that kind of information up. So we need to give the information up, give it to the defense when it's relevant to the case, when it's the kind of evidence that might be helpful to them in defending their case, if it's something that might be helpful to them in cross-examining a witness. But other than that, we need to keep the identity of informants confidential.
You're mixing issues again, and here's where you're doing it. And here's
where you're not mixing any issues.
Here's where it's problematic. The Orange County Informant Index disclosures have nothing to do with the disclosure of the identity of informants. The index disclosures come up once an informant has been disclosed. Let's go back. The cases we've talked about, we've gone back through a 30-year history. We've talked about it. Eric Peterson, he disclosed witnesses in three. Oscar Morial, he put on trials, three separate homicide trials. He never disclosed that he was a signed up informant with the Orange County District Attorney's Office. That had nothing to do with protecting identity. In the Decry case, Fernando Perez, they just didn't want to turn over the fact that there was a Orange County Informant Index entry that said, do not use as an informant. Go back to the 1980s, Thomas Thompson, when it said all this terrible evidence about Edward Fink, an informant, one of the most notorious informants in the state, that was not disclosed. It had nothing to do with protecting the identity of the informant. It had to do with making your case stronger by omitting impeachment evidence.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Sanders. Can I give another panelist an opportunity to talk? But you know what? We're going to give everyone a chance to talk. I'd like to turn to Attorney Saavedra right now. Tony, what have been the biggest challenges for you reporting this particular series of stories for the past 2 years?
Well, as you can see, this is a very sensitive, complicated, nuanced story, and it has required that kind of attention. We have to be accurate. We have to be fair, and we know that everything that we put out there is going to be read with an eagle eye by both sides, who have their various sensitivities to various parts of it. And so that's been one of the big things. The other is that because there's some active cases involved, people aren't going to be talking as much and going on the record and talking. And so this is a story that's had to be put together basically all based on court records and other types of documents, and you know, some easily obtainable and some not so easily obtainable.
And hundreds of interviews? Any idea how many people you've interviewed over reporting this story?
It's been dozens. It's been a lot of people, including people behind bars.
So these are complicated issues that involve far more than the Decry case. And I'd like each of you, I'd like to start at the end of our panel. And we're going to give everyone a chance to talk here. Moving forward, because that was the focus of our panel, is to talk about what next for the Orange County justice system. We've all read the history. We know what came before. What are the lessons? What are some of the lessons at Humes that we have learned from this? What are the takeaways?
The lessons, we should have more of these. It's quite lively. It's, you know, it's obviously a still evolving issue. You know, we just had a case last week out of Fullerton that was overturned because of the role and the disclosures made or not made about an informant. So it's the second time that case was overturned, conviction was overturned. So it's still playing out. If the question is what do we do looking forward, I think it's not so complicated. There's some really fundamental, maybe one big fundamental issues. You know, the district attorney has perhaps the most challenging job in public life. I mean, look what they have to do to, for the non-lawyers in the room, if there are any, you know, you may think that the DA's job is just to win convictions and lock people up, but their role, their duty, what they're sworn to do is to see justice done. And part of that process is, you know, this whole Brady process. It's a half century old legal principle. They use it every day in their office, multiple times a day in every case, right? And it basically comes down to don't hide the ball, you know, supply the information that's legally required, even when it hurts. I've heard Mr. Baytieh talk about this, you know, even when you know it's going to affect the probability of securing a conviction, you still have to turn the information over, right? Even when it hurts.
Yes.
That's a hard job. That's hard to do. And that's why, you know, the Supreme Court says your job's not just to win your case, to notch victories. Your job is to see that justice is done. So how do we help the DA avoid problems with this and achieve that job? I think that's the big question. How do we make the system better? We're humans. We make mistakes. If there was negligence, well, that's just as bad a problem as if it's on purpose. If someone's conviction is reversed because it shouldn't be, because they're dangerous, that's a threat to public safety. Or if someone who should not be convicted ends up in prison, that's a threat to liberty. Neither outcome is good. Is it a matter of training? Is it a matter of office culture? Is it leadership? Is it because there's not enough oversight or accountability in the process? Those are the kinds of questions that need to be answered from all parts of the system and maybe outside the local system to get fresh eyes on it. That's what I think is the big lesson.
Mr. Baytieh?
You know, when you first talked to me about this event, our office, and you said you wanted to have a discussion with members of the community, I think that's wonderful. And I think you have a lot of people here that are stakeholders in our community. But I think it's equally important for us to be able to look at it accurately. I appreciate any defense attorney who wants to protect his client's rights. There's one thing I disagree with Mr. Sanders about, the notion that the criminal justice system in Orange County is broken, or the only way for somebody to get justice in Orange County is by way of luck. I absolutely disagree with that. I think all these specific issues relating to specific cases, that's why we go to court. That's why we go to court, and a defense attorney will make his position, the prosecutor will present his or her position, and the judge will make a decision on it. The problem, though, when you have members from the community talking about this and listening to this, see, you notice what you heard today. You heard about there is a secret informant program that the DA's office and law enforcement is intentionally hiding from the defense. And the example that was given to you is a statement from a search warrant where the declarant said, part of my job is to get information from informants. You know, sometimes in our jails, we have 500-600 inmates being watched by 2, 3, 4, or 5 deputies. Those deputies have a right to get to go home at the end of the day. And part of doing that is to get that information. If we don't get information from inmates, more crimes are gonna be committed, less crime are gonna be solved, and people are gonna die. That's the reality. I agree with Mr. Sanders. We have to do it on the up and up. We have, it's our obligation. I have a right to make sure that his client is getting a fair trial. I also have a right to tell you the state of the evidence right now, there isn't a shred of evidence that a prosecutor conspired to intentionally hide evidence from a defendant. Now, Mr. Sanders can disagree with me. That's fine. We go to court. A judge will listen to all the evidence. I trust our system. I trust that at the end of the day, a judge or a reviewing court is going to review the facts and make a determination. You know, Mr. Saavedra talked about some informants were promised a Xbox. You know, the law allows us, you know, we talked, and Mr. Rackauckas talked about it, the difference between a Perkins operation and a Messiah operation. The law allows us, if we have somebody who's suspected of a crime, if that person is in custody on crime A, but we suspect him of crime B, and he's not charged with that crime, the law allows us to take an undercover cop or an informant and tell that informant, go see if you can get him to tell you about that crime. Because I am willing to accept that an informant's gonna get an Xbox if that gives me and gives a prosecutor the ability to sit across the table from the mother or the daughter or the son or the husband of a victim and tell them, we did what we could within the law to solve the crime where you lost your loved one and you had to bury your loved one and you missed them every single day. We have an obligation to do that. You know, I know you were there and Mr. Sanders said something about this is gonna be solved when as a society we care about defendants as much as we care about victims. With all due respect, I don't accept that. The law requires me to give defendants all the protection that they're entitled to. We do that. We have an obligation to do that. And you are right. Sometimes we make mistakes. We're human beings. We're going to learn from those mistakes and we're going to move forward. But I am not going to care from somebody who walks into a business, takes a gun and points it to the head of a human being to kill them as much as I care about that human being and their mom and their dad. I think that's the reality of the life that we live in, and we have to be willing to accept it. If you invite people to your newspaper and you ask them to be more educated, I think we have an obligation to tell them all the facts. The notion that some deputy sheriff wrote in a search warrant that part of my job is to collect information from inmates, that's their job. We want them to do that. And then to turn that around and say, look, that's evidence that they have a secret program where they are conspiring to violate somebody's right. From my perspective, that's not right. Now, Mr. Sanders can disagree. That's okay. Why we go to court.
That's
why we litigate that issue in court.
Mr. Rackauckas? Just to refresh on the question, what are the main takeaways, the most important lessons moving forward?
Well, you know, we have a lot to do. I mean, we have a big job in the district attorney's office, and that was just alluded to. So we need to work on all kinds of cases. We handle somewhere in the neighborhood of 70,000 cases a year. 18,000 of those, something like that, are felony cases. We might be involved in an informant case on 8 or 10 or some number like that out of all those cases. So it's a very, very small percentage compared to the large number of cases that we have. Also, most of the time when information is offered to us by somebody who's an informant or somebody who's in custody in the jail, we don't accept it. We don't take it. We just move on with the case and don't deal with this person who wants to be an informant. Like for example, in the Wozniak case. Now, Mr. Sanders brought up a little bit ago that this Fernando Perez was an informant in the Wozniak case. Well, he was not. What happened in the Wozniak case was that he came forward, he offered to be an informant, and our deputy district attorney who was handling that case refused it. He said, absolutely not. I have no intention of talking to him. I've got plenty of cases here. I don't need to worry about having an informant. Gave that information to Mr. Sanders that happened, and that's how Mr. Sanders found out about Mr. Perez. So we have this a major job to do, and we need to move forward, and we need to continue to do that job. And we're doing, I think overall, I think we do an excellent job in the district attorney's office. We've got a lot of fine deputies and deputy DAs and investigators and a lot of good support staff, and they're doing a terrific job, and they're bringing justice in many, many cases for the people of this county. So we have to continue to move forward. Now we found some areas in this informant area where in these decry hearings and in the allegations that Mr. Sanders made in Wozniak, none of which were proven to be true, but the allegations and looking at that, we've seen that we do have some issues. And for example, before we take a case that we're going to prosecute from another agency like the federal government, we put things in place to make sure without question that we have all of the information that is necessary for us to be able to make the complete discovery that's necessary to make sure that the defendant has a fair trial. So we're putting those kinds of things into place. We're adding to the training, on, as you can see, there's some differences and some fine lines with respect to informants and who can say what and when it might be admissible or not admissible, when it might be required to be discovered. So there's a lot of training to do. We've increased that training very substantially, not just with the DA's office, but also with the local police and the sheriff's department, bringing them into the training as well, so that everybody's clear on what the rules are, so there aren't any violations. We've done some other things to make sure there are no violations with respect to the use of informants. So before any informant will be used, before we accept that we're going to use an informant in a criminal case, we have a committee that's going to review that question, and we're going to get all of the information, all the details. By the way, this is already ongoing, so not necessarily just in the future, but I sit on that committee, and no informant is going to be used in a criminal case going forward that hasn't been accepted, that where the idea hasn't been accepted by that committee. So there are a number of things that we're doing to ensure that we don't have any of these bumps, but we need to continue to move forward. And I tell you that we're going to continue to use informants when necessary and important and lawful in criminal cases, because we have a duty to investigate those cases, to get the evidence, and to bring criminal defendants to justice, particularly when they commit violent acts against innocent people.
Okay, thank you. Sheriff Hutchens, same question to you. What are the lessons learned moving forward?
Thank you.
What's the takeaway?
Well, I think the takeaway is it's not a perfect system, but there has been no deliberate misconduct. It is a nuanced, as Tony said, very complicated legal system that we follow, but it's an excellent legal system that we have in this country. You've heard some conspiracy theories that there somehow we're colluding, the sheriff's department is colluding with the district attorney's office, that we have this TRED system that is a secret informant monitoring system. None of that is true. It is just not true. I would welcome if federal government wants to come and take a look at our system in the jail. I don't care. I have nothing to hide. The Attorney General's office is conducting an investigation on a few of my deputies, and quite frankly, I think Judge Gothels went a little too far in his comments, and I believe the investigation will prove that to be true. But let the investigation take place without passing judgment. If anybody conducted misconduct, I'll deal with that. I've dealt with that in the past. Nobody wants anybody in law enforcement who is not telling the truth, all right? And so that's not what the citizens of this county elected me for or elected the district attorney for. We believe, I certainly believe, I do not want to violate anybody's rights. None of the deputies that work in my jails or work on the streets want to violate anybody's rights. They want to do their job and they want to do it right. The vast majority of the time that those deputies in the jail spend is for the care and security of the inmates. An infinitesimal period of their time is dealing with what you would call a true confidential informant. It is not an everyday occurrence. What is an everyday occurrence is getting information from inmates who come forward. When I worked the jail, I would have inmates come forward to me and say, Deputy, there's going to be a fight in here tonight. You need to know that. Or Deputy, they want to get after Deputy so-and-so, and I don't want that to happen. Or Deputy, there's drugs in the dorm, and I don't want to get in trouble. So I know from firsthand, having worked in the jails, that is a daily occurrence. And it's important for those deputies to act on the information. That is not a confidential informant. That is just getting information from an inmate that takes care of the safety and the security of all the people that both work or are in the jails as an inmate.
Thank you, Sheriff Hutchens. Mr. Sanders, I think we might have some opinion on this. What are the lessons learned?
That we're not advancing here. This is not the answers we need to move forward. They're just not. Mr. Baytieh says, I'm not going to look at defendants like I look at victims, and you know, uses the most explosive case and says, look, I understand that you can always do those things. You can rev people up, but let's not look at them then with the same value as victims. Why don't we just look at them as our children in prison or our loved ones and say, how would you feel if you were watching this and you learned that for 25 years, the treads were kept secret. And those treads have all sorts of incredible information. I could spend an hour talking about what we've seen in four or five treads that changed the whole equation of evidence and the whole analysis of credibility. So if it was your kid and your kid's been in prison for the last quarter century, and it's no big deal, it's not a big deal. If it was one person, it would be a huge deal. And it's not one person, because you've been keeping treads on every inmate. And there are treads literally on every person who has come forward as an informant in at least the last quarter century. Same thing with the Orange County Informant Index. If you heard this conversation and it's like, it's literally no big deal. We're moving forward. You're not moving forward till you address the past. A justice system doesn't work that way. And so when you tell us we've changed policies, I don't care what policies you've changed. There's law that's been in existence for more than a quarter century that's told you what to do. Turn over favorable evidence. You don't need policy changes. That's like, you know, that's like if we change the different words on the paper, we'll start following the law. Just follow the law. You've had all the policies you've needed for more than a quarter century. Judge Conley did not make a decision about 40 of the cases. He made a specific finding that he would not analyze this. So when we talk about honesty, hey, Mr. Sanders, be honest. We've been cleared of everything. You've been cleared of nothing except for, as you correctly said, the intentional misconduct of the decry team. That's what you've been cleared of. And I would add, and Judge Conley said that the Wozniak prosecutor did not commit misconduct, but there have been no hearings in Wozniak. And there's no hearings coming, folks. There's no hearing, so it's going to be up to some outside force, some other force, to tell them this isn't good enough. Your answers are simply not good enough. So what's the answer here moving forward? Someone's going to have to tell them it's not enough to simply get up here and say mistakes were made. The evidence didn't hide itself. There were human beings involved in hiding, and I could go through case by case. And the truth is, they can't. Jim Tanizaki told the LA Times in November, it would take months to look through each of Mr. Sanders' allegations. That was in November. I'm pretty sure, sitting here in February, you have not looked through the allegations. So why are you telling people nothing has been intentional? I want to just say one last thing. Why are we not moving forward? What's the evidence we're not moving forward in the Henry Rodriguez case that was just, the defendant was just granted a new trial because in 2006, both TRED and Orange County Informant Index records were not turned over. A deputy walked in from the sheriff's department and he said, by the way, I've got 4 years of notes that I've never turned over. 4 years of notes about their day-to-day experience. Now, the thing that I brought out in decry was, you're not being truthful, deputies, when you're meeting with informants, and you are meeting with informants, and you claim that you created no notes. That's what the testimony was. These deputies claimed, I meet with informants, I create no notes, no reports. Finally, in 2016, this deputy comes forward and says, I've got 4 years of notes that I've never turned over. And let me just say what Judge Gothel said. His words will be far clearer than mine.
If a deputy makes relevant notes, the fact that he or she decides not to never to share them with anybody doesn't make them irrelevant. It just makes them secret. And I'm not sure what to think of these notes in light of some of the issues that we're talking about in this case and other cases. The day before the deputy is due to testify, he comes forward with a bunch of notes covering a period of 5 years that deal directly with on-duty activities. A cynic might say, how many other such records are there floating around out there? But there has to be some way that the sheriff can get across to her deputies that you can't create essentially a secret a cache of private classification notes and information containing potentially relevant information and just keep it to yourself. How many other notes are there? How many notes? Scary. It's scary. A lot. I'll guarantee that folks have been keeping and not turning over notes for 25 years. So this is not a little bit of an accident problem. This is a decision that was made, and whether it was accidental or not, the final thing I would say, Brady doesn't care. The law doesn't care. It says if you're sitting in prison and you didn't get your information, you're entitled to it, whether there was a conspiracy, whether it was purposeful, you get it.
Okay, thank you. Tony? What do you think are the lessons learned here?
Well, responding to Mr. Rackauckas and Mr. Baytieh, I do know what Perkins is, and I do know that it's allowable when there's not a Messiah issue at stake. One of the reasons I brought up the Xbox, one of the reasons I brought up all the money that was made, one of the reasons I brought up that all the perks and the offers of quote-unquote consideration, which means some type of leniency when they're eventually sentenced, is because you're incentivizing testimony. And it seems like when you do that, there's more of a tendency on the part of some, you know, informants not to be so truthful so they can get the goodies. And I think that's a danger. I'm not saying that it's not right to use informants, but that when you do use them, that it's got to be regulated and that the laws that exist have to be followed. And I think going forward, it's just paying more attention to that.
Thank you. Mr. Rackauckas, I had a question for you. We opened talking about the Decry case, and I know that's a very emotional case for people inside your office, people throughout the community, and particularly the victims' families. Some of the families have said at this point, can we just put the death penalty aside and move on? Have you had any further thought on that, or can you discuss it?
Well, of course, I've given that a great deal of thought. And, you know, some of the families have said that, and others don't feel that way. So it's not a unanimous thing. But I do need to say that it's unfortunate, first of all, that this case has gone through what it's gone through. I think one thing that I think is certainly a positive is that Decry has pled guilty. He's pled guilty. He's admitted all of these crimes, and so the only thing left here is what the penalty is going to be. Will it be death or life without possibility of parole? And I think that it would be wrong for me to decide not to proceed to the death penalty in this case. It would be like throwing in the towel on the death penalty statewide. I mean, I think that if you look around, the state, you don't find a lot of worse cases than this. And if we're going to have a death penalty, and that's maybe a little shaky if it's going to be continued into the future. But if we're going to have a death penalty, this case deserves the death penalty. And I'm not going to give it up and give up the entire death penalty. Going forward, I mean, I don't see how I could not seek a death penalty in the Decry case and seek it on other cases in the future that are not nearly as heinous as the Decry case. Although all of these murder cases tend to be heinous, but this is a mass murder. So I think given the circumstances, given this case, given the all of the proportionality of the other cases, we're not going to back down from the death penalty.
So I'd like to give each of our panelists the opportunity to make some final remarks. And I'm thinking about something that's a quick lightning round. I'm talking lightning round 1 minute. I'd like each of you to tell our members of the public in approximately 1 minute, make your closing argument. What should people take away from this evening? Tony Saavedra.
I think people should take away the idea that when it comes to justice and the justice system, how you do it is as important as what you do. And whether it's in the intentionality or whether it's a mistake, to someone whose rights have somehow been violated, it doesn't matter. People expect, and I know that it's a system that's operated by human beings, so it's imperfect, but it seems like it's got to be as perfect as it can be, and especially when dealing with informants, that there's got to be the utmost of care in dealing with them. And I know that in a lot of cases they say that, well, they're corroborated by other evidence, but I can cite a couple cases where it wasn't. They were corroborated by more informants. So, again, it just seems like, and as far as the defendants, they can't take it for granted. They got to question, and they got to make sure that they can't take it for granted that their rights, that they're getting all their rights.
Mr. Sanders?
Yeah, this is a trust-based system. For you, those of you that don't understand, on both sides, it works that way. We get the discovery that they want to give to us. I don't have a right to invade their office and start searching for things. So when we have an experience like this, the question is, what's the takeaway? Many of us leave it for good reason, not trusting. Informants are the most dangerous witness in the system. I think all of you know it. I think it's widely understood why. They're motivated. Look at Fernando Perez, Oscar Moriel, who've been in custody now for 10 and 9 years. They're working and working so they can get lowered sentences. They're incredibly motivated people. If you will not comply fully with your disclosure responsibilities in this context, don't expect those people on the other side, once we learn what we've learned, to ever trust that with other witnesses and other evidence, you'll turn it over. So the takeaway is, boy, if you're not being clean as can be with informants, I'm not going to believe you're being right in the other context where it's so necessary. So the takeaway here, we've got to be more vigilant. Defense counsel have to be more vigilant. The community has to look at this. And the last thing I'd say to the community, this is up to you. The truth is, sorry, this is gonna flash it up a bit here, but they want this to go away. They don't want a redress. They don't want any redress of the past. If you look at what they did in Rodriguez and what they said in this case most recently, they're actually arguing that the TRED records, if TRED records were held back, we're not part of the prosecution team, so that evidence shouldn't even be considered as you move forward. So the bottom line is they don't want to go back and fix any wrongs. They want to move forward. Let's forget all of this. This is a community responsibility. Community, are you going to say, yes, it's okay, we'll move forward, we'll have new policies, we'll have new directives? Or are you going to insist that if one person, one single person, didn't get their evidence when they were entitled to it, that it's going to have to happen? It's only going to happen here if people speak up. So this is your community. Decide how you want your justice system to look now and how it will be looked back upon 10 years from now, 20 years from now.
Thank you. Sheriff Hutchens, what should people take away from this evening?
Well, I have to address the TRED again, unfortunately, because Mr. Sanders keeps bringing it up. The TRED is not a separate system. It's a classification system, period. There is no separate system, so I want to make that very clear. What I really want to say is I want to thank the community for coming out and being involved in this. It's not a question of any of us wanting this to go away. It's a question of what the truth is. It always comes down to what is the truth at the end of all of this? And that's what the justice system is about, is getting to the truth. And the truth of the matter is, Nobody wants to violate anybody's rights. Nobody gains anything by violating anybody's rights. And everybody up here has been as candid and as open about this as they can be, given that there are certain things in the jail that I can't talk about that have to do with security, given about the fact that we can't always give an informant's name for their own protection. And those are decisions made by courts. So it's a matter of getting at the truth. You've heard a lot of allegations by a lot of people. I think we're all trying to do the right thing here. We have made some course corrections. I disagree that nothing's been done. And again, it's about getting to the truth of the matter in this instance and in all instances in justice. We want justice to be served. We don't want anybody in jail who doesn't belong there. We want to give the discovery that is asked for, and we make every attempt to do that. Is it a perfect system? Absolutely not. Do we learn from our mistakes and move forward? I think that is the question that we have to answer tonight. And I think in this county, we learn from our mistakes and we move forward. But I would say to you very, very clearly, the Orange County justice system is not broken. Far from it.
Mr. Rackauckas.
So, as far as questions of accountability are concerned, on a case-by-case basis, with every case, there are hearings. The defense has an opportunity to make objections. The court has an opportunity to hear the evidence and make decisions. And whenever something comes up, like it did in Decry or any of these other cases, if something comes up, if a defense counsel wants to reopen something or have a hearing concerning something or needs some evidence, in general, we make sure that they get that, and we are happy to go to court and to have the defense make their motions, and we respond to those. So there's a lot of accountability. I mean, that's what this is all about. I mean, the reason all of this is taking place now is because we had hearings, there was evidence presented, things that were heretofore not known became known. And so these things all are tending to come to light. So as they do, and as it points out that there in fact were some mistakes made, or that we didn't get all of the information that we should get to give it to the defense, or we had a position in a case where we didn't think that we had to give them certain evidence, but we gave them certainly the ability to make the motions. If the judge decided we do need to give them that evidence, then we do. We turn it all over. So there's honesty in the system. I mean, this is not a corrupt system. This is not a situation where people are hiding the ball and the defense never gets it, and there's various nefarious things that have happened in the past, and all these people are in custody who shouldn't be. When we find out somebody's in custody and there's a question about it, I mean, I've had the experience myself in cases. Well, particularly one case, a murder case that I prosecuted and where I convicted the defendant, or I did the case and the defendant was convicted. Some years later, at the behest of the public defender, I took another look at it, did a reinvestigation, worked on evidence that the public defender already had at the trial. But we kind of developed that more and developed a question as to whether or not this defendant was guilty. And if our situation is that we're not sure that the defendant's guilty, based on all of the evidence that we have, he might not be guilty, we make sure that he doesn't spend any more time in custody, because we don't want to put people in jail who don't belong being there. And that brings me to another point. All of these accusations that are being made, all these charges in the Wozniak and Decry and these other cases, nobody has suggested that there's any false confession, or that any innocent person has been convicted, that any evidence has been made up. This is all a question of whether or not a right has been violated. For example, the right not to be asked questions by an informant when a person's in custody. That's what it is. And so I think it's important to keep all that in perspective. So our system is a good system. We're bringing cases where the evidence is strong and where the people who are being charged with crimes have a right to a fair trial. They get a fair trial, the justice is being handled day to day, hundreds of cases a day, thousands of cases a year, and I think the people of in this community have a very good system of justice and a very good law enforcement partnership that they can all be proud of, and that's why we have as safe a community as you can have, frankly. We have the safest community, Orange County, safer than all of the surrounding counties. And so I think it's something we can all be proud of.
Mr. Baytieh, your lightning round.
I think everybody in this room, what I would like them to take away, this is their criminal justice system. They should take an ownership interest of it, and they should know it's not a broken system. It's the best system on earth. It's not perfect, but it's the best system on earth. And I think you take an ownership in it in realizing that I have an interest as a prosecutor, just like my next door neighbor, just like my friends that are defense attorneys, to make sure that it's a fair system. I think it will be a shame for anybody to think that 280 or so prosecutors don't wake up every morning with the intention of carrying their duties in a fair and just way, to hold people accountable in a fair and a just way. You know, people can say there are 1,400 pages of motions and 25,000 pages of exhibits. That's not what's going to carry the day. It's what's the fact, what's the truth. I think people should take away that we have put stuff in place. Every single cadet that's going to graduate from the Orange County Sheriff's Academy, before they graduate, they are now mandated to sit and listen to a four-hour training on Brady and Messiah and Perkins. I think that's healthy. I think that's good for our system. I think we don't give up on our system because even though it's not a perfect system, it's a great system. And I refuse to accept the notion that it's luck that carries the day. It's not. We may disagree. Defense attorneys and prosecutors will disagree about certain facts. We go to court. But I think what will be a shame is for anybody to go home and forget that the prosecutors that do that are part of the community just like you. They're your neighbors and your next door friends and the people that you went to school with, and we have an interest in that system just like you do. We're not gonna get it right every single time, but we wake up every morning and our objective is to do it the right way. And I think that's something we should all be proud of.
Ed, what's your closing remark?
Well, I'm gonna take the journalist's position, which is that transparency is often the solution to what we're hearing today. We have polar opposite views of what happened and why. I don't think it's going to be resolved in-house. You mentioned that there may be a federal investigation. I think some outside review, whether it's the grand jury or academics recruited from UCI and Loyola, whatever it is, it needs to happen to resolve the conflict. Why do we have, six cases that have been identified that have been impacted by failure to disclose information about informants? How did that happen? How can it be avoided in the future? Whatever findings this outside the house investigation reveals should be transparent and publicly available so that we can all see how these questions can be resolved. I don't think it's gonna happen in-house. I think there needs to be more transparency and throw open the doors and get to the root of it.
I'd like to take this opportunity to thank each of our panelists. This is a remarkable, in all the years that I've been writing and editing and telling stories in Southern California, I can't ever remember such an event with people of this stature willing to sit and have a very civilized and open discussion. So thank you very much. So we ran a little bit over on time, but we'd still like to have some questions. And I'd like to invite people to ask some questions, but first I'd like to put some ground rules on it. It's really important. We've had a conversation here. We'd like to continue it. We'd like you to come and ask your questions briefly. No speeches, please. Keep it concise and keep it courteous. We have someone over here who is handling our microphone, and if you, Rob can handle the, anyone? Do we have anyone who'd like to ask a question?
Tony, I think a lot
of the can you please identify yourself and just introduce yourself to the
room,
please?
My name is Brian Gerwitz. I'm an attorney in the community.
Okay.
Tony, I think a lot of the criticism that you've heard about has to do with not simply the informant scandal, but how you responded to it by questioning the motives, for example, of Judge Gothels, Scott Sanders, Erwin Chemerinsky, and some of the former prosecutors who called for an investigation, even though you later called for the same investigation. It reminded me a lot of what happened in 2002. In 2002, there was a criminal grand jury investigation of you put on by the U.S. by the Attorney General. He did not indict you, but issued a scathing report. After that report came out, you called it politically motivated, you questioned the Attorney General's motivations and the motivations of the people who made the complaints against you. That prompted the Attorney General to call you the worst managed district attorney in the 58 counties and say that you held your office up by your response, not
okay.
by what you
Okay, so we set some rules. Do I hear a question in there,
yes.
please? Thank
Setting
you.
Setting it up to statewide ridicule. Do you see a parallel between the criticisms that you're getting about the way you've responded to this as compared to how you handled the, you responded to the criticisms of the grand jury investigation in 2002? A similar defensiveness.
My response to the allegations and to the things that that the district attorney's office has been accused of in this case has been to question the people in my office, to look at all the information that I could get, to have regular meetings concerning things that are taking place. To determine what, if anything, is going wrong, and to work to fix all of those things that we find that might need where we might need to have things tuned up, change here, change there, and so that's pretty much what I'm doing, and I think that that's the appropriate response. The response to look to see if we're making any mistakes and to make a determination. If we are, let's fix those mistakes and move forward.
Okay. Our next question.
Yes. My question is, what are you doing to look into all the cases where officers have lied on the stand, district attorneys have refused to turn over evidence and lied about the evidence? And I'm going to tell you about my case, which contradicts what you both have said, Ms. Hutchens and Mr. Rackauckas. In my client's case, the informant was a known snitch. I was told for years he was not. The informant tried to kill my client. Your deputy sat in on the interviews and were present when he said, "I actually stabbed him and my orders were to kill him." Instead of being charged, the informant was released. He had admitted to several other murders. So you are taking this case and overlooking the fact that you are releasing murderers back onto the street. I am a citizen. I have children. And because of your informant problem and your lies, it took me 2 years to uncover the evidence that your office fought tooth and nail. These murderers are going back out on the street. If it wasn't for another case where the informant's information and the judge said, "Oh, by the way, this doesn't apply to your client, it applies to my defendant," I never would have learned of it. Then after my client's case was dismissed, instead of doing the right thing, I uncovered evidence that your officers lied on the stand, knowingly committed perjury. I had to fight to get the court.
I'm sorry, I don't want to interrupt, but can we focus on a question, please? We have a very brief period for questions. Do you have a key question?
My question is, what are you doing? I had to fight to get the co-defendant released because your officers lied on the stand. Your office did nothing until we presented the evidence to you. What are you doing to go back through those cases that the informants admitted that they lied on, that the informants are deemed unreliable informants and have taken 400 pages of notes? Are you looking at those files to determine the accuracy of the informant's information?
Well, I think what you're charging us with at this point is criminal conduct.
Yes.
And
yes.
Yeah, right. And that's
Good evening. My name is Gabby Hernandez.
I'm
sorry.
So I'm not familiar with that particular case and all the evidence and all of the things that you're talking about. But you know, that if there is evidence of a crime, then you know, we need to hear about it. It needs to go to the Attorney General so that it can be investigated. Like, for example, there was an Attorney General who was present for all of the all of the hearings in the Decry case, all of the discovery motions, the motions to recuse, all that business in the Decry case, to make a determination as to what they might need to do. And so there was an investigation that was determined to have to take place after all of that. The Attorney General's taken that and is looking at it. And I would be very happy to turn over any evidence you have as to wrongdoing or criminal conduct to the Attorney General so they can look at it, or to the U.S. Attorney, so they can look at it and make some determination as to you know, what you're saying, the credibility of what you have to say, the evidence that you have. You know, I think it's fair to look, to investigate, and to determine whether or not something wrong has actually happened in that case. So if you would care to present that to us, as you probably have, well, let's get it together. I don't know the name of the case, but I'm happy to make sure that it gets properly investigated. So you'll have to tell us that.
I submitted everything to Ebrahim.
Okay. Oh, to Ebrahim? Okay.
Thank you.
Well, then maybe he can respond. I don't know, because I don't know the case.
Okay. The case that you mentioned when we did the Chapman presentation, and I promise you, when you emailed me that stuff, I actually emailed you saying, send me everything that you want to send me. You send it to me, and I promise you we're looking at all the stuff that you're alleging. However, you have to give me the courtesy of being in a position to tell you I disagree with your factual conclusions. Now, like Mr. Rackauckas said, we have zero problem with having an independent agency look at it. We looked at your declaration, we looked at your affidavit, and we're looking into it. But you talk about it as it's a done deal. And with all due respect, you and I have tried cases in court where I get up and I tell the jury, this is what I believe happened, and you get up and you tell the jury, nope, what Baytieh said is wrong, I believe differently. That's okay, that's part of our system. There is a place for us to resolve these disputes. It's a place where you and I live most of the time, inside of a courtroom. And we're absolutely willing to do that. Absolutely. No question about that.
Okay. Thank you. Our next question, please.
You know, there was a question said about we want it to go away. I can promise you we don't want it to go away. We're looking at every single aspect of it, because we want to be doing better. So there is nothing that has been brought to our attention that we haven't looked into, and we're continuing to look into it.
Gabby Hernandez, and thank you so much, Mr. Sanders, for your bravery in covering all this information. There's a lot of people here rooting behind you. And no, we will no longer be fooled by Rackauckas and the OCDA and all the corruption that has been going on for just years. And so we, the public, the community, have been working for months now with different communities, different community members, organizations, and committees, and we have launched a petition for the federal government to investigate you. And you said that you're open to it, and I hope that you are, because I do not trust that you guys can police yourselves.
Okay, do we have someone next with a question?
I said we were open to that, and we are. So I'll be happy to cooperate in any investigation done by the federal government, the Attorney General, whatever other authoritative body is brought to do that.
Hi, my name is Dan Nichols, and I'd like to ask the sheriff and Mr. Rackauckas if either of you are willing to do as I suggested in a 2 February letter to the Orange County Register, and that is to resign your positions over not only what we heard today, but also the fiasco of 3 criminals on the loose for 8 days, not being discovered for 15 hours, not being caught by your department, losing an AR-15 in Aliso Viejo. So are you willing to consider resigning?
No.
No.
Okay. Next question.
Hello, my name is Steve Hare, and I've been hearing a lot of people blasting the DA's office. Our son's case was just resolved, and Mr. Wozniak got to murder, getting a death sentence as he deserved. The justice system works. I didn't like the delays. We waited almost 6 years for this, and it works both ways. I don't know about prosecutorial misconduct or snitches or what, but I do know this. In our case, the snitch was told a year after he was done that he was not going to be used, and yet that was a cause for a two-year delay. So it goes both ways. You might have the mistakes in the prosecution, the DAs, but you also got it in the defense attorneys. So my suggestion is iron it out, get over it to an extent, and never forget that, but we have to move on. Thank you.
Can I respond? Mr. Herr, I mean, one of the things when you talk about the delay, I'm going to respond to you since you came today and you were kind enough to ask the question as you did. I just think fundamentally one of the differences that we have is I think just your understanding of what our motion said. Our motion wasn't simply about was there an informant on the case. I certainly understood, I know you've said it many times in papers, that look, they disclosed to us that they weren't going to use the informant. The motion was really about the bigger issue of whether the district attorney's office should be able to impose the death penalty based upon a range of conduct that included that.
And if I can respond, Mr. Sanders, I absolutely get that. But it was this one case, and I believe you were bringing back cases 30, 40 years ago, which had nothing to do with our case, so if I might finish.
Sure.
That your assumptions and your accusations can be still brought up regardless of whether we tried our case or not. My opinion was is that you delayed our case, well, you know, to get your point across. I'm not saying your point is not important, but in our case, it was never a factor. And it was also the judge had found it in our favor, but it was never in our case. So what I'm saying is I felt in our case, and it always has been our case, not the rest of the cases that you've been arguing, in our case, it never existed, therefore it should never have been delayed for an extra 2 years.
Mr. Herr, I mean, this is just one of those things. You know, you've sat on both sides of the table on this,
yes,
on these issues, as you and I both know. And the case that you were involved with, your lawyers very strongly advocated about constitutional issues and rights issues, some of which you won and some of which you lost. You believed in it, your lawyer believed in it, and believe me, the prosecutor's office in that case didn't agree with you, and the victims probably didn't agree with you. We both did. Your lawyers did what they believed was right. I did what I believed was right. And I still do. Regardless of the adjudication, just like in your case, you got some rulings you liked, you got some rulings you didn't like, but I believe probably you think you were right about them. I think I was right.
And I'm not arguing with that. I felt obligated to come up because the district attorney's office is not all bad. They helped us. We got the verdict. We felt justice was served. It's just that we felt it was delayed. I'm just answering this question. Okay. Thank you.
Thanks. You very much, Mr. Herr. Thank you for coming out tonight. I think we're done with our questions. Thank you, everyone, for joining us. I'd like to invite Rob Curley to come on back up. We have, as we wrap up now, we have coffee and cookies in the lobby. If anyone cares to continue the conversation, we would certainly welcome. We have a lot of our staffers here, and certainly we have our guests. But thank you, everyone, for coming out tonight.
Thank you. Look, this is the role of a newspaper in 2016, is to help do these things. So you all were a part of that tonight, and we're honored that you came. It meant the world to me. This was a lot like a newspaper. Sometimes you read it and go, yeah, that's great. And sometimes you go, man, those guys are drunk. Okay? That's okay. This is what it was all about. And I'm very honored that you all were here tonight. So thank you very, very much.
Thank you.
And thank you all. It means the world to me that you all came here.